We've often said this, the Indian market works in its own unique way, which also means that what may work in the global market may not necessarily appeal to India. One of the best examples of this fact is the compact luxury segment. Now, we don't usually associate luxury with the hatchback body style, which is the reason why the A-Class or the 1 Series didn't do too well. Then there was the CLA, that beautiful four-door coupe body style, but even that didn't appeal to the Indians the way Mercedes-Benz hoped it would. Now, that is one of the reasons why the new CLA is nowhere on the roadmap for Mercedes-Benz India. What they have coming instead is the A-Class limousine, because they believe that there is space and there's more appeal for the classic three-box sedan body style. But then again, the Audi A3 was a classic sedan that only made that initial splash and then just disappeared into the blind spot of the Indian clientele. But so did the A4. So let's just blame that on the design. BMW thinks that they can do better at this body style. In fact, BMW knows how to handle the entry-level clientele. They have done this quite successfully. They have the entire Mini lineup to address this particular client. They have the BMW X1, which is the best-selling crossover in this segment. And now they think that this addition, a four-door Gran Coupe, could also appeal to many. Say hello to the new BMW 2 Series.
The 2 Series is a new model line for India, but in the BMW universe, this is the second generation of it. The Gran Coupe suffix means that this too is a four-door coupe like the CLA, and this body style is all new for a BMW of this size or nomenclature. The first generation 2 Series had an active tourer variant, much like the Mercedes-Benz B-Class, which thankfully didn't come to India. But the primary variant was the two-door coupe, and we got a glimpse of it with the M2 Competizione.
That was a stunning car, both in the way it drove and in the way it looked. The new 2 Series tries to replicate that design, but it just doesn't look as sharp. Unless you take a topish angle like this, then it looks good on Instagram. If you think otherwise, let me know what you think of the design of this car. What I feel is that the photos and the videos just don't do justice to what this car looks like. In flesh, it certainly looks a lot better. So if you are shopping in this space, definitely do pay a visit to the BMW dealership, take a look at the car, give the car a chance, and then make your buying decision.
Despite marrying the styling cues of the 8 Series Grand Coupe to the compact size derived from the 1 Series hatchback, the 2 GC has ended up looking quite blunt, and the face has a very upright and chubby appearance to it. Blame it to the Z4 or 8 Series inspired headlights, the detailing of which makes them look more vertical than horizontal. Adding further to that effect is the kidney grille, which sits lower than the headlamps, robbing the 2 GC of the low-slung look that we usually associate with BMW saloons. This problem is typically seen on sedans that are derived out of hatchbacks, where the nose looks a tad bit stubby and upright for the kind of proportions we expect from a 3-box style. And we have a whole crop of sub-4-meter sedans that are apt examples of that.
I can't believe I'm saying this, and don't call me a hypocrite for saying this, but I think this is one of those BMWs which would actually look better with a larger and a wider grille on it. I also feel that the bonnet shut line should have been set a little forward, a little more discreetly than what it is right now. And a final bit of complaint is with the headlamp. While they look fine from where you are looking, but from the side profile or the rear three-quarter, it's got that ungainly bulge to it, much like the CLA.
The side profile has balanced visual proportions, and with the 18-inch wheels and the fat 225 section tires, it even looks like a premium sedan.
I think the best angle to view the 2 Series from is the rear three-quarter. It looks like a proper sports sedan fit to wear that Bavarian roundel. Of course, there are those big air dams, all that sporty drama that's happening up front with those M Sport bits. But I think even with its simplistic styling, even with the lack of all that drama, the tail end looks a lot sportier than the front.
The rear looks dramatic in its own way, with the two functional exhaust barrels, the sleek diffuser, the even sleeker tail lights, and the gloss black applique running between them.
Continuing with the bits I don't like this little camera jutting out from here. It should have been incorporated inside the roundel. Even a Polo does that. It did that a decade ago. The BMW should have done it now, for sure. What I do like though, is how this boot lid sweeps up to give you that spoiler effect, nicely complements the coupe roofline.
Unlike the 4 Series Gran Coupe sold internationally, the 2 GC avoids a hatch opening to save costs. The conventional boot lid hides away a sizable 430 litres of cargo space and has a 40-20-40 split on the foldable seats for additional space or versatility. Should you catch a puncture during your travels, there's a space saver that is neatly tucked into the floor so it doesn't compromise on the luggage space. Furthermore, a 12-volt socket conveniently placed near the boot opening allows you to use the inflator within or around the boot itself without having to run cables all the way to the dash.
And despite the coupe roofline, ingress and egress is actually not a problem at all. Of course, for taller passengers, this is going to be a bit of a squeeze, but for my height of 5'8", the headroom is actually not quite bad. I have about 2 inches of space over my head. Of course, like most coupes, there's a bit of space that is scooped out here, but you can only fit 2 adults and a kid in here because here you have the lighting mechanism, so the headroom is much lesser than what you see on top of my head. Again, like a coupe, because this space has been scooped out, the panoramic sunroof doesn't extend all the way to the back, and yet you have a nice and airy feel in here. Now, in terms of the space, foot space is quite good, knee room is excellent, this driver's seat is set to my driving preference, and under-thigh support is not bad at all. In fact, this space is quite comparable to the E93 series that was launched about a decade ago in India. So from that standpoint, this is not bad space at all. Like I said, 2 adults and a kid shouldn't be a problem at all. But then again, this car is ideally suited for couples or nuclear families.
The fairly roomy rear seat comes courtesy of new age packaging, and more importantly, because this isn't a rear wheel driven Bimmer. Don't go away just yet though. We will come back to this configuration in a bit. The rear seat gets 2 USB-C ports and AC vents too, but this cabin comes with a 2-zone climate control only, and it's primarily the front seat occupants that it wants to pamper. The front seats are comfortably large and roomy, and the cushioning is comfortable for long distance journeys.
Because the 2 Series is targeted at those with a younger bent of mind, it's got a sporty interior. Of course, it's typical BMW, so you get a driver-centric dashboard, everything is angled towards the driver, and that's very good news. But you don't get any wooden inlays. What you get, all the textures, all the inlays, are much sportier and techy in their appeal. And that is what feels very nice and youthful in this cabin. Adding further goodness to that effect is the presence of ambient lighting. You get the BMW assistant, the voice assistant, and you also get gesture controls, which up until now were only restricted to the high-end cars from BMW.
All these features up the premium quotient and gives even an entry-level car like this plenty to talk about. The M Sport trim seen here also comes with the M steering wheel and a 10-speaker audio unit, which is one of the best this segment has to offer.
You also get a digital instrumentation, again inspired by the BMW Z4, which means it gets the reverse tachometer. You can also specify the car with a heads-up display, it's an optional extra, and then you also get this infotainment screen. It's touchscreen, it's not the biggest in the business, but it is very crisp, very easy to read because it is angled towards the driver, and it's got a very slick response as well. What I also like is it gets wireless Apple CarPlay, which means you also get a wireless charger, and I really like the placement of it. It is something similar to the cassette type wireless charger that we saw on a similarly priced MG Gloster. However, this one has a nice rubber beading or a rubber lining inside, so unlike the Gloster, it's not going to crack the tempered glass on my phone, and the other soft materials around also ensure that my phone doesn't get scratched at all.
Despite the slightly bulbous bonnet and the high-set dashboard, the visibility is excellent. Like a typical BMW sedan, you get a feeling of being a part of the powertrain and not riding atop it.
As of now, the BMW 2 Series is only offered in India with a diesel engine. It's the familiar 2-liter 4-cylinder turbocharged engine. It's in the familiar 190 PS tune as well, and in this little package, it's quite explosive. There is a petrol variant, of course, that's a 220i, but it has been recently shown in the global market, which means it'll take a while to come to India, maybe a few months from now.
The transversely mounted diesel has exceptional refinement levels, and the 220D M Sport tested here managed a 0 to 100 sprint of 7.7 seconds in our test.
You wouldn't really have to look at the spec sheet or really have more talent than these onboard electronics to know that this is a front-wheel driven car. Now that is something that has upset a lot of purists in the past as well. Every time BMW does a front wheel driven car, we've seen that with the X1. However, with the new age electronics, it's actually not that bad a thing.
The engine is mated to a piece of tech that BMW calls the ARB, or Actuator Contiguous Wheel Slip Limitation System, which essentially controls understeer that results out of excessive power or torque that is fed to the front wheels. It is a common problem with front wheel driven cars, but with new age electronics that can work faster than ever and using new age sensors, the car's ECU can prevent or preempt excessive understeer, meaning you don't have to be too measured with the throttle all the time.
So let me tell you what all this jargon really translates to out on the road, especially on winding roads like the ones that I'm driving on right now. So at slow speeds, it feels a little assisted. By assisted, I mean if you've played computer games, racing games with the steering assist on, where it also gives you a little bit of steering assistance to follow the line that you have, the ideal line that you have to follow. It feels a little bit like that when you are at slower speeds. It feels a little more assisted. It feels that the steering is doing a little bit more than what you expect of it at a particular angle of steering input that you're giving, which isn't exactly a bad thing. It's just a matter of getting used to. And once the speeds start picking up, it almost feels like a mid-engine car. Of course, take that with a pinch of salt. Don't come running behind me with a knife. Don't stab me. I know what a BMW purist expects out of a sports sedan, but this one actually does feel like a mid-engine car. That is how well-tuned the electronics are, especially at moderate speeds. There is a nice sense of weight balance. You don't feel that there is a bit of nosedive or there's too much understeer or oversteer of any kind. Of course, when I say mid-engine cars, I'm not drawing any parallels to cars like the Cayman or any of the 718s. I'm not going that high up the order. But when I say mid-engine car, I'm talking about the kind of weight balance it achieves, the kind of balance it gives you when you're tackling bends, when you're going around fast switchbacks. It almost feels like the pivot point is right at the center, and that's a very good feeling.
Of course, it doesn't feel as natural or as joyous as a typical BMW sports sedan. But at the same time, it doesn't feel like the kind of compromise that a front-wheel driven configuration would suggest.
It's only when you start pushing this car to its absolute limits, that is where it will start showing you its limitations of a front-wheel drive configuration. That is where it will tell you the difference between itself and something like a 3 Series. BMW won't like to call itself the ultimate driving machine if it doesn't like to give you a very good feedback from the steering wheel. It has to be quite chatty, right? And that's exactly what they have managed to do even with this front wheel driven BMW. Now the only catch to that is, despite all the fine-tuned electronics, especially on our kind of road surfaces, if there are mid-corner potholes, the mid-corner bumps, poor road conditions that suddenly take you off guard, they take the electronics off guard as well. Because the steering at that point tries to replicate everything that's happening on the road and give you that feedback, tell you what's happening at every wheel. And at the same time, the front wheel driven configuration, the electronics trying to break the inner wheel and all that jazz happening, you can feel that the electronics are actually working overtime to try and maintain the line. And sometimes it just can't do it. Of course, things never get unnerving. The electronics do make sure that you will still maintain your line the way you intended to, but there is quite a bit of kickback that you get on the steering. You can feel the electronics doing their thing, trying to make sure that the car is staying on its line. And that can sometimes just kill the fun a little bit.
Honestly, it is marginal. Not something that will push you into the roadside ditch or the side of a truck when powering out of corners or overtaking maneuvers.
I quite like the way the gearbox is tuned and the way it responds to changing throttle inputs, whether you're driving in the city, out on the highway, or on the twisties. It feels a little bit more responsive in its tuning compared to what we've experienced in the X1, and that's a very good feeling. The gearbox also gets a coasting function when you're on the highway, and that essentially helps this car get a phenomenal fuel economy as well. This is of course a diesel, so compared to what the petrol would manage, it will certainly give you a better range and better economy. But I like how the gearbox has been tuned and how relaxed this engine runs. For example, cruising at 100 kilometers an hour in comfort mode, it takes hardly 1400 RPM. And cruising at a more realistic 120 kilometers an hour, hardly takes about 1900 to 2000 RPM. So that essentially tells you that the engine runs nice and relaxed at highway speeds, and that is what maximizes the fuel economy as well.
The gearbox isn't as intuitive as the ZF transmissions in the higher spec BMW sedans, but this icing unit seems to be tuned for slightly quicker responses than before.
There are driving modes, of course, but the most basic kit from the BMW universe. So you get the Eco Pro mode, you have the Comfort, and you have the Sport. And you have three switches for them laid out on the tunnel console, and I'm not too happy with the placement because of the placement of the starter button. It's happened quite a few occasions, especially on these twisty roads, that I had to move from Comfort to the Sport mode, and I ended up pressing the start button every now and then. And then I have to take my eyes off the road and take a look at where the actual switch is. And I don't think this is a matter of getting used to. It is certainly going to be something that's going to be confusing. Now, why am I switching between modes if I'm on the twisty roads? Why am I not just sticking to the Sport mode? Well, that's because the power delivery in the Comfort mode is actually a lot cleaner and more linear as compared to what the Sport mode manages. There are some tight switchbacks around here on the roads that I'm driving where in the Sport mode, the car tends to have a torque steer despite all those electronics, and that's sort of killing the fun. The Comfort mode still makes it a lot more enjoyable because you don't have that sudden surge of torque coming in. It doesn't feel a little too eager, a little too enthusiastic when you're driving around tight switchbacks. And that is where I think the Comfort mode is where you will enjoy most of your enthusiastic driving as compared to the Sport mode.
While the 2 Series is targeted for those with a sportier bent of mind, its suspension is set up for a relatively cushier ride. There are no adaptive dampers to firm things up, but I doubt if you will complain about the stock setup.
I quite like the feel of the brakes, and even on speed breakers, which you're going to encounter often like I just did, it's not a big worry. That was something that was a massive, massive worry with the CLA. You had to be almost as cautious as you would be with a sports car because that car would scrape its underbelly everywhere. This one, however, doesn't do that. In fact, the ones that we are driving on right now are not that bad, but I have subjected this car to some really tall speed humps, and where some of the other German sedans scrape their bodywork very easily, this one hasn't quite.
What you have to be careful about are the low-profile wheels on poor road conditions. But these again are premium car tantrums one cannot avoid in India. And it is a caution that you have to exercise for being a part of the luxury club. In a nutshell then, the 2 Series is certainly a better buy than the CLA was, because it has a sprightlier engine, better dynamics, and a more comfortable cabin. Furthermore, it has enough tech to keep you entertained and ensure that you don't feel shortchanged for the Bavarian badge. It is also more accessible than a BMW X1 diesel, which makes it a sweet deal that will attract a lot of newcomers to the brand.
Well, now the all-important question. Will the 2 Series give birth to a whole new generation of BMW enthusiasts? Well, maybe not in the way the rear-wheel-driven, tail-happy 3 Series did, but in the way of its pricing, in the way of making it more accessible, I think it will. Should you buy this over a 3 Series? Well, for the kind of price gap that it offers, if you don't need that additional space, if you don't need that rear-wheel-driven configuration, if hitting winding roads often is not going to be your cup of tea, if you are purely looking to buy yourself a BMW, something that you're going to be using more in the city for your everyday commutes, going to office, going to work, maybe a few weekend jaunts here and there, the 2 Series will do everything just fine. It's even got the tech, it's even got all the feel-good features that you want inside a car of this order. So from that perspective, it has you covered. But if you're an out-and-out driving enthusiast, if you are a BMW purist and this is going to be your first BMW, you might want to stretch and get yourself the 3 Series instead.
As always, do let us know what you think about our verdict. Do you think the 2 Series, being a sedan, can make any difference to the entry-level compact luxury space? Or is it just the crossovers that catch people's fancy? Let us know in the comment section below. And don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to OverDrive on all social media networks. Thank you so much for watching.